So, thank you. What we have seen yesterday is if to solve a conjecture, we, at least I am interested in, and sorry, is the following. If X is special, equivalent to, should be equivalent to being so what I call the potentially dense in both versions. And so this requires to solve the same conjecture. Once the definition with suitable definitions for this is due to requires. Maybe I should explain this. This is because of the decomposition of a core map C, which is equal to J or N. Here, this is in the orbifold category. The orbifold category for orbifold pairs X delta, which are smooth, and so I will recall what is it, smooth, and such that, even, and I will not recall the definition, kappa plus of X, kx plus delta is minus infinity, or kappa of X, kx plus delta is zero. So this is essentially this thing, and we need also the case where kappa of xn, kx plus delta, this is n, n being the dimension. But here in this case, we want this to be modelling. So essentially, we are just reduced to a larger extent under this decomposition to treat this special case. But now this looks simpler, but on the other hand, we have to deal with a larger set of objects. Let me recall what is the meaning of X delta smooth. This will be, this means that X is smooth if X is smooth, and delta, this will be always written like this. Delta, this is a sum, a finite sum over some j's of 1 minus 1 over mj here, and here I will have some divisors. Delta j, this is on X with the support of delta, which is the union of a dj, and which is SNC of simple normal crossings. So this is the situation. We have this, and so we what we would do is to have this. But now we need to say a little bit in order to say that this is potentially dense. For example, we need to know at least in the analytic situation what are the entire curves on these objects. And what are also the integral points, in fact, on these objects if everything is defined over a certain field K. And so this is exactly what we are going to do here now. So first, for the analytic version, so we want to know what is the meaning to have an entire curve inside of a delta? So we have to impose some conditions. So the situation is this. Yes, I will not have the time to explain why this definition is given, but this is essentially, this comes if you look at the vibration and if you have a certain orbifold base, what you want to say is you have a certain orbifold base and the curves you want to consider below, these are the ones which are projected down from the thing because you have these multiple fibers. And so this is a translation of this condition. And so we, now I'm here in this situation. I hope I don't forget to say anything. Okay, analytic version. So I take C, this is a curve. A curve not necessarily compact, but this is a connected, smooth, complex, manifold of dimension n, one, of dimension one. So the only interested cases in which we are interested in essentially is when either this is compact, but the main things, this is when we have a unit disk C or P1. So these are the main cases we want. And so the definition is that an orbifold morphism H from C to X delta to X delta, this is a holomorphic map H from C to X, which I will assume it not constant. Not constant, and such that we have two conditions. The first condition is that H of C is not included in delta, in the support of delta. And so the second condition I will give non-classical conditions is that, yes, for any J belonging to J, so this is the set which is here. So delta is given here, is here. For any J, I have H star of DJ is greater than or equal to MJ dot H minus one of DJ. So this is the inverse image of DJ here on C. So this is a certain set of discrete points. And so for these points, I want to have this inequality. I will describe it more precisely. So the MJ, this is the same thing as the one which appears here. So this means that any in order to say this, in the classical, excuse me, for the classical notion, classical orbifold morphism, this will be for any the same thing. But what we want is to say that how to say, that MJ H minus one of DJ here divides H star of DJ. So I will make this more explicit. So this is means for any point A which belongs to C, if and any J, if there is some, such that H of A belongs to DJ, we want in two to have T J I is greater than or equal to MJ, where T G A, this is the order of contact. of H of C with DJ at H of A. In order to be a little bit more precise, I can write H star of DJ. This is TJI dot A plus something else. So this is the definition. So if you lift it, so you get here at least the multiplicity. You get exactly multiplicity TJA, and you want this order of contact to be greater or equal than MJ. And for the classical thing, classically, you want to have TGA to be a multiple of MJ. So this is the notion. What do I want to say? Yes, and then we say, for example, if C is... Pardon? Sorry? Yes, this would happen, yes, for GCD. And this will happen for the inf multiplicities. If C is P1, we get delta rational curve. And possibly we can write it for classical. If we have this condition, so this is the classical. If C is C, now we get a delta entire curve. And you have also the classical notion which appears. And so I will maybe denote by a holomorphic of C and X delta here. So this is the set of all such morphisms, orbifold morphisms. And so I will denote with all star of C, X delta, this is the set of all classical such things. So if you want, we will have that in general, we have hol of something, this is greater than or equal to a whole star of the same object, and this is also, this is greater, yes, and this is, excuse me, is it greater? Yes, and this is here, this is obviously the just the holomorphic C of X. So here you have no condition. Here you have just the greater than or equal condition, which is less restrictive than the divisibility condition. So you always have these ones. And so now we can say.
Closeness of the image?
Of the image? Of C. It depends on C. If C is the complex plane, certainly not in general.
So for instance, say any curve in X minus delta is fine.
Is? No. If it's not in X, excuse me?
Take any curve on X minus delta.
Any curve on X minus delta. Curve in X minus delta, you have no condition, this is okay. This is okay, yes, and so actually this is exactly what you get if you would take MJ is plus infinity. For any j, then you get the purely, this is the purely log situation. So this also applies, in fact, in this situation. You can get this, for example, you see, because if you have mj is infinite, here you have one. And so you just get the usual log situation. And the holomorphic maps, these will be exactly the ones that you were saying, which are those which avoid entirely delta. So we have this. Yes. And so now we can give the same. X delta is uni-rule uni-ruled, so we have the same, this is the obvious definition. Is it clear? But you have now two notions, classical and non-classical. What you just have to replace is to replace the arbitrary rational curves here by orbifold morphisms from P1 to X delta. Replacing Hall by Hall of Hall of P1. P1 and X delta. Is it clear? It doesn't seem. So you say that X delta is uni-ruled if it is covered by delta rational curves. That's the same definition, but you just take, for your orbifold, you take the, instead of taking the arbitrary rational curves, you want to have those which have a certain condition. X delta, this is rationally connected now. If you have the same definition, but now with the delta rational curve. So you want that two generic points are connected by a delta rational curve. And so the conjecture I make is that kappa plus of x delta is minus infinity. This means that x is delta rationally connected. Delta rationally connected. Oh, X delta is rationally connected. Delta is rationally connected. Kappa of X delta, this is minus infinity, equivalent if X delta, this is uni-ruled. So this is these are conjectures one can make here. And so the point also I wanted to say is that yesterday Johan told us about the Kobayashi pseudometric, pseudo distance. Kobayashi pseudo distance. And so this has also, this is delta x on x. So you can define it. He gave a definition, but a little bit quickly because of lack of time. And so we can do actually the same, exactly the same here. And we have, in fact, two versions. So this is the classical version and the non-classical version here. They are defined exactly in the same way. This is defined using unit disks. But here we want just to use unit morphisms, orbifold morphisms from the unit disk. So you just replace the standard definitions by these contact things, and then you get the similar objects. All these objects. So this is what I wanted just to say briefly. So we have this, and actually, yes, in terms of, maybe there is a better X special. In the analytic version, we can say that X is a special should be exactly equivalent to the fact that the Kobayashi pseudometric here is identically vanishing. So this means that every two points are at distance zero for the Kobayashi pseudometric. This is the case of on Pn easily and on abelian varieties, for example, but there are other examples also among these Caffrey surfaces, for example, which are the interesting case. So we have this. And now I will go to the arithmetic version. The arithmetic version, now in order to define, we want to define integral points and so on. So this takes a lot of time in general because you have many things to introduce. And so I will do this only in one special case, but the idea is very clear. This is the same as in general. So I will assume that X now, this is just a P1, and then delta, this one will be delta of RST. These are three positive integers, at least two, for example. So in order that this is interesting. And delta RST, this is the orbifold, if you want. So we have a P1 here, we have three points, 0, 1, and infinity. And so we shall put here the multiplicity R, here the multiplicity S, and here the multiplicity T on the infinity. So if you prefer, so this is just 1 minus 1 over R dot 0 plus 1 minus 1 over S 1. So this is this divisor plus 1 minus 1 over T, the divisor infinity. So these are, of course, these divisors on P1. And so the definition for these integral points, which we want to define, and I will define it even only for k is equal to q, but the extension, if it's not complicated, but notationally, and so it takes much time, so I will just do this in this special case, and where there is already an unsolved problem, even in dimension one. And so we have this, and so yes, the definition will be modeled on the analytic version. So on the analytic version, so what is, we will change a little bit the picture, so assume that we have, here we have a curve C, and here we take P1, for example, this is, we take the product. Here, this is C cross P1. And here we have maybe this projection F, for example. And what is now, what is just the, any map from C to P1? This is the holomorphic map H. So we are considering C, a map from C to P1. And so this is just, this gives us something. This is the graph. Graph of H. We just look at the graph of H. And now if we are given these three points with multiplicities, they correspond also to, we have three particular sections here. Maybe we have here the section zero, the section one, and the section infinity. So these are just the point, the product points, any point in C and zero. Any point, so these are special sections. And so if we take, if H, or say that H is an orbifold morphism, from C to P1, delta, and here also additionally, I have also multiplicities R, S, and T. The multiplicities are here. This means equivalent, this is equivalent now. I will draw the graph that for, I have, this corresponds to a certain section. So what is the condition on the section? The condition is that at each point, for example, if I take the non-classical condition, at each point I want the order of contact of this section at this point to be at least, or here maybe, I will put this, here, I want to, this to be at least R. This is the order of contact, greater than R. And here, I want this to be at least S. And here, if I come back to here, for example, and this, that this is greater than or equal to T. So do you see these sections? Now, they will have to have a strong constraints in order to be, to correspond really to orbifold morphisms. And now this drawing, this permits us now to translate this in the arithmetic condition, to the arithmetic situation. The arithmetic situation will look like this. Now what we say is that this is essentially this C. We look this now at the spectrum, this is the set of valuations. Maybe I will, maybe. These are the evaluations of a field of rational functions or meromorphic functions on C. So this corresponds to the valuations of this. And now we, if we replace this by the K, K is equal to Q, so we are looking to the valuations, and so what we will get, except for the infinite value valuation, to spec of Z, which is the set of prime numbers, 2, 3, and so on. So the change is this now. So we replace this okay, by the set of valuations. And so we get the spectrum of C. And so we will replace now the product here that we had here by an arithmetic surface. So this is a surface here, and we will replace it by an arithmetic surface. And so this arithmetic surface, I don't know how the people in arithmetic geometry, which notation they use, but so what we get now is maybe, let me call it maybe, this is not a good notation, but I will put this P1 of Z. Now this will be the arithmetic surface, and so this, we map it by maybe a map of pi in such a way that over each point, a prime number, the fiber, over any p in spec of z is just the reduction modulo p of p1 over z. For example, so this is just, this is equal just to p1 of z modulo pz. So this is just the curve, which is here. If you prefer, I make a small drawing, maybe, which is not very good. So we have here spec of z, and so we may have 2, 3, 5, 7, and so on. And here, what we get, here we get just the 3 points. So we have 1, 0, 1, and here we have infinity. For this is just a P1 over the field of in two elements. Here we have 0, we have 1, we have the class of 2, and here we have infinity, and here we will have maybe 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and here the infinity. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So this looks like this. And now, in this, now if we take any x, which is a over b, which is in p1 of q, so this is just q union infinity here. So this gives us a section, gives us a section of pi, for example, and each which is given, this is just ap divided by p, and so xp. So this is the reduction of x, which is a over b modulo p. Okay, so we get here in this sense a certain maybe a certain section here. This we get a section which is associated to any rational number or to the infinite point. Excuse me, I should have said that A and B are coprime. I take always coprime integers here. Now, so we have this, and now, so this means that here we have 3 sections. We have the section, now the section 0. Here we have the section, maybe it is here, yes. Here, this is the section 1, and here we have the section infinity. And so, exactly in the same way as we did before, we want to say when is this section an orbifold morphism in some sense. And so, for this, let us notice that when does the section x meet the section 0. The section 0, so this is very easy. This is exactly when A is divisible by P. So this means when, this means for which prime numbers does the section at this point meet the section. And so this means the this is translated in the this means exactly when P belongs to what is called the radical of A. And the radical of A, this is the product, this is the product of the primes of P, which divide A. So this is exactly this. This is called the radical. And the section X meets the infinity, meets the section infinity exactly when P belongs to the radical of B, is essentially for the same reason, because you just take the inverse, if you want. And now we have section X meets the section 1 exactly when for P, which belongs to the radical of A minus B. And because A and B are coprime, all these primes are coprime 2 by 2, in fact. So we have this condition. And now, OK, so we know at least when the section will meet these three sections. But we need also to have something which replaces the order of contact. The order of contact. This will be replaced by the arithmetic intersection number. This will be, and so the arithmetic intersection number, this will be X. And for example, I want to make the define this in intersection arithmetic intersection number for X and 0. At P, for example, for each P, I will define a certain intersection number. And so this is the exponent of P in the prime decomposition. Prime decomposition of A. So we have this because we have, and so this will be 0 if P is not in the radical of A, but on the other hand, in if P is in the radical, then so you have another another invariant which comes naturally, and which is this exponent. This is the exponent of the this is the value of evaluation. You see, so this is exactly the same definition as here, because this is the value of evaluation. Taken. So we have this is the arithmetic, and of course x1 p, this will be the exponent, but now for a minus b, and x infinity of p, this will be the same, but now this will just for b, for example. And so now I think we are in position to define what are the integral points. The situation is the same as here. Over, say, non-classical integral points of x of p1 and delta, these are just the x equal a over b, such that we have x0 of P is greater than or equal to R for any P. I have to say if X zero P is positive, we have X one P is greater than or equal to S, and this is essentially for the same X one P is positive. And here we have the same So we have these three conditions, and x infinity of p is greater than t if x infinity p is positive. So these are the non-classical integral points. So this corresponds to say essentially that the section x here, it will meet the section with in arithmetic intersection number at least R, S, and T. And so these are these conditions. We will translate these before. So the classical ones, we just have x zero p is congruent to zero modulo R, x one p congruent to zero modulo S, and x infinity p is congruent to zero modulo T, and this is for any p. So these are the classical notion, classical points. And so I will denote this by, for example, p1 delta of q, maybe. And here I will denote them by p1 delta star of q. We have always also, obviously, we have p1 delta star of q, this is included in p1 delta of q. Because these conditions are more restrictive than these ones, for example. And now I will maybe translate this. We will translate this. This looks maybe a little bit difficult to understand what it means, but here this is very easy to see. What does it mean? To say that x zero p is congruent to zero modulo r, what does it mean? This means that each time you have a prime which divides a, then it appears in at least with a multiple, the exponent is a multiple of r. So this is a multiple also of, this is a power of p power r. And so this means that a, this is plus or minus one, a certain alpha power r. But this is an exact half power. And now in the same way, we have x infinity p is congruent to zero modulo t, if and only if we have b, this is plus or minus one, a certain beta power s, power p. So this has to be, excuse me, with alpha positive and beta positive, and in z, these are positive integers, sorry. And x one p is zero for any p, modulo s, this if and only if we have a minus b, this is plus or minus one some gamma power power s here. And so what are we looking for? So the elements of this, these are exactly the solutions to the equation with integral solutions in Z to the equation plus or minus alpha R plus or minus, maybe I will write it, beta S is plus or minus gamma T gamma S. So we have now an exact, we have an algebraic equation, and so these are the solutions. So we shall see, and what happens now, what about the non-classical notions? And here the situation is not very difficult also. I will let you as an exercise to check this. Now that the condition, for example, x zero p is greater than or equal to r for any p, such that this is positive. It's positive. So what does it mean? This means that the exponent, exponent of P for any P which divides, if you want, in short terms, this means that A is divisible by radical of A to the power R. This is exactly the same thing, obviously. And so this means that each time you have a P which divides A, its R power divides A. So this is, and I will write this maybe in the form alpha power R, that A is alpha power R. Maybe the notation is not very good, but this is a symbolic notation, just to say that A is its radical, but to something which is greater than R. Okay? So this is the definition. And now the equation becomes, but this is much less obvious to deal with. In fact, the plus or alpha R plus or minus beta, you just have to T is plus or minus gamma S. And so this is not obvious to mean. This has no exact algebraic meaning. So, so you have more solutions to this. And now I can come to the orbifold model conjecture. So now we have P1 and delta, which is delta R S T, for example. So we have this. Now we are interested in the, of course, we would like to know what is the distribution of integral points on this. And so this depends, this should depend exactly as in the non-orbifold case on the degree of the canonical bundle. If the degree is negative, so this is a P1, so you have infinitely many solutions. If the degree is zero, infinitely many solutions. But if the degree is positive, then only finitely many. This is an analog of Faltings. And now let us compute this. The degree of KP1 plus delta, this is delta. This is easy to compute, and I will not make the computation. This is 1 minus 1 over R plus 1 over S plus 1 over T. So let me call this delta. So the conjecture is this. In this situation, if delta is positive, only finitely, maybe P1 delta, in fact of K, which I have not defined, should be infinite for any k prime containing k, which is q, for example. And so if delta is less than or equal to zero, this should be infinite for any k prime large enough. And so you have a similar, situation when with P1 delta star of K. So you have a similar conjecture. And so the fact is that this is solved. This is something which is called Faltings plus epsilon. So this is the title of the article. This is by Darmon-Granville. So this is solved in all the cases which are here. And the difficult case is when delta is positive, because then you have a generalization, in fact, of Faltings. theorem. The point is that in this case you can make, you always have an orbifold etal cover of your P1 delta, which is an orbifold etal cover, which is of a general type, which is a curve which has to be of a general type. And the fact is that the points you have in this situation, you have also the, how is it called? Yes, Chevalet-Weil theorem, which tells you, in fact, that you can lift the rational points upstairs, below, to rational points upstairs on the cover, and then you apply Faltings. But this needs really the fact that you have a divisibility condition. If you don't have a divisibility condition, you have no such lifting. And so the situation is completely obvious. So in this is completely open. In this case, so this case then, yes, this case also, in fact, what I would like to say is that this case is in fact easier than this one in the when you have delta which is less than or equal to zero, because you have more points here. So you, if you have already infinitely many points here, then you have infinitely many points here. But here the difficulty is here, so you have more points, but you want to have finitely many points here. And the fact that you have finitely many points here doesn't tell you anything. I just want to conclude, I still have some, a little bit of time, with some, two remarks. The first remark is that if you want to, the number of points of x of a, let b, positive be a large number. Large number. Then we look at the a in z plus such that a is of the form alpha power r here. So this means that this is this bears a name. This means that A is R-full. They call, the people in arithmetic, they call it like this. So this means that it is divisible by the half power of its radical. If you look at this, maybe I should have started. Yes, such that A is less than or equal to the bound B. And so we are interested in the asymptotic growth of this number of R-full numbers. If instead of having R-full numbers, if you have exact half power, the evaluation is very easy because this is B power 1 over R, essentially, asymptotically. But here this is still true, that there exists a certain positive constant, CR here, such that this is equivalent to B power 1 over R. So this means that essentially up to the constant CR, you have a similar rate of growth as for exact power. This is a small indication that you don't have too many R-full numbers. This is a thing which is due to Erdős, and I believe this is in the 50s, 60s, something like this. And so so the evaluation is essentially known asymptotically. So this means you don't have too many R-full numbers, but still more. So this does not give anything. Of course, this is not a proof. But the second observation is that the ABC conjecture, ABC implies the orbifold model conjecture, the one which is here. And so I will show you how this is proved. But as usual, when you use ABC, everything is completely trivial. And so this is the case here also. So what does say ABC? ABC says that if you have, for any triple of coprime integers, coprime belonging to Z, such that you have A plus B is C, then you have if you put M, which is the maximum of A, B, C, then you and for any positive constant epsilon, there exists a constant C epsilon positive, such that M maybe yes power one minus epsilon. Ah, maybe I will write it. Yes. Such that yes, the radical of A B C, which is radical of A, radical of B, radical of C, because they are coprime. So that this is greater than or equal to M to C epsilon dot power M minus epsilon. So you have this this inequality. So this is the conjecture for any epsilon. And so if we apply this, we shall see that this implies immediately over Q in fact the finiteness, because you will have now, if we have now A is alpha R, B is beta T, and C is gamma S, for example, then this implies, for example, I have A, this is certainly less than M, and this is certainly larger than the radical of A to the power R here. So we have this in the similar way. This is greater than or equal to, and maybe I can rewrite it in the form M power one over R is greater than or equal to radical of A. And so in the similar way, you have M power one over S is greater than or equal to radical of C, and M to the power one over T is greater than or equal to the radical of B. And so this means now, implies, then I still don't have applied the ABC conjecture. This implies then that M power one over R plus one over S plus one over T, this is certainly greater than or equal to the radical of A, radical of B, and here, radical of C. And on the other hand, now if I use the ABC conjecture, this should be greater than or equal to C epsilon times M power one minus epsilon. I still don't have chosen epsilon. So, but this means now that if I divide this, so C epsilon power minus one is greater than or equal to M power one minus one over R plus one over S plus one over T, which is here, and here minus epsilon. And so this is M to the power delta minus epsilon. Delta, this is the one this is this one. Yeah, this is the degree of the canonical bundle. This is the degree of the canonical bundle minus epsilon. So if we choose epsilon, which is less than delta, then this gives you imply that M has to be less than or equal to C epsilon to the power one over delta minus epsilon. If I'm not wrong, yes, I believe to the power minus this one, and so you get a universal, you get a bound for this, and so this means that now A, B, C are bounded, of course. But this is using, this is fairly remarkable that you have exactly the canonical bundle which enters into the picture. And here now, just a small remark that namely, in fact, for any or ST such that we have delta is positive, we have, in fact, delta is greater than or equal to 1 over 42. Just because, and this 42, this corresponds to R is 2, S is 3, and T is 7. And so for the other ones, they are larger. And so which gives a canonical bundle, which is, excuse me, is it greater? This is smaller than or equal to 142. This is smaller. Because you have to choose things which are larger than this. Okay, and so this means that this is smaller. Ah, yes. And so when you take larger and larger, this is strange. I think, did I make a mistake here? Ah, this is 1 minus, so this is okay. Ah, yes, 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 thank you. Thank you. Ah, yeah. No, no. In fact, delta is always greater than or equal 1 minus 1 over 42. So this is a thing. Okay. And so this means that you have, in fact, you can choose this uniformly. If the bound which works for this one will work for any. So I will stop here.
That the other direction, that OMC does not imply ABC.
Probably not. Probably not. I believe that this orbital model conjecture should be much easier than ABC. Much easier. My guess is that, for example, this orbital. It depends on which kind of guru you believe in. So either if it is Stolzer or if it is Mochizuki, Mochizuki, Fezenko, and.
My concern is that if it is not known to be false, the other implication, that means OMC conjecture could be as hard as the ABC conjecture.
I believe this is very difficult, of course, because everything is completely inaccessible for the time being. But at least there is a small indication that this ABC, this ABC, for example, it has a function field version. The orbital model conjecture, for example, over functions field over C, I have proved it a long time ago. It's not very difficult, in fact. Over function fields of curves. And the proof is algebraic here. On the other hand, for ABC, the only known proofs which exist over function field over C, they are analytic. I think there is no algebraic proof of ABC over function field over C. But there are relatively easy proofs, algebraic proofs. So in my impression is that this is much harder. So I think the best thing to try is to try an algebraic proof of ABC over function fields. It's very difficult to compare them. The only indication is that over function fields, there seem to be a big difference between the two things.